Hello and a very warm welcome to Discussion Today with your host, Kriti Mishra. As per the report of the Bureau of Police Research and Development, there is a jump of 16.05% in women personnel in the police force this year. This was observed in the released data of Police Organizations 2020. The data shows women constitute 10.30% of the total 20,91,488 strong police force in the country. In central armed police forces like ITBP, BSF, CRPF, CISF, SSB and NSG, total percentage of female police still remains at 2.98%. It has happened for the first time in the history of the Bureau of Police Research and Development that data for a particular year has been released during the year itself. This data will be more useful for the users, especially for the policy makers, police officers, researchers, police administrators and other stakeholders, as it has come out timely. And to further discuss the issue of representation of women in police forces, I'm joined by Dr. Vikram Singh, former DGP Uttar Pradesh, and D. Rupa, Inspector General of Police, Karnataka. Welcome to Rajya Sabha Television, both of you. Ma'am, coming to you first. The total strength of women police from 2014 to 2019 has shown an increasing trend. In 2014, it was around 1.11 lakh, and in 2019, it was 2.15 lakh. Nonetheless, the journey is still far away, but certainly it's a marked improvement. What is your take?
Yeah, the trend has been very encouraging, and the society is changing. Gone are the days, I wouldn't say fully, but partially, where women would be discouraged by the family members not to join the police force. I think today every arena of work is open to all, and people realize that there is no such distinction as a woman's work and a man's work. And the families, especially, you know, the parents, the husbands, they have to encourage the woman to join the police force. If they don't and discourage and they say that koi bhi aur naukri mein jao but don't go to police force, then not many women will come forward. So I think the society is changing. That's a very big heartening thing to note. And at the same time, the department also has decided and is welcoming women. Long ago, even when some women wanted to join the police force, they were not welcome. The recruitment to various ranks, be it in the paramilitary forces or in the state armed police forces, they started off late. And as we all know, even when Madam Kiran Bedi wanted to join the IPS, she was the first woman IPS officer to join. And even then, it was not open, but however, she expressed, she volunteered, and then she was made to join with a lot of hurdles. So it is heartening that it's very encouraging, and I hope this trend continues.
Yeah. Absolutely. Dr. Singh, D. Rupa says society is changing. Women cops are marching ahead. Your take, sir.
Prakriti ji, women cops are not only marching ahead, they are stealing a march over their men colleagues. If we want a thing to be done better, entrust it to the women personnel and the women police officer, and they will do it much better than the male counterparts. All of us suffer from misconceptions that perhaps women are not meant for police work. But after 20 years of exposure, I can say with a lot of hands-on experience and personal experience, if there is greater integrity, professionalism, and no-nonsense approach to a work culture, the women police stations are the living examples and embodiments of excellence and professionalism in the police department. Whether it is integrity, whether it is honesty, whether in fact, if there is a communal situation, both the communities say, entrust it to the lady police officer, Mrs. Suraj Kaur Mehra, my late batchmate. These are living embodiments and examples of the fact that women have left an indelible mark on policing itself. And whatever be, there are lady officers who have won the outdoor gold medal and the Prime Minister's baton and the pistols in the National Police Academy. We have true illustrious lady directors of the National Police Academy. What more proof does a person want that wherever you give the opportunity to lady officers, they do better than the men, especially when it comes to integrity, investigation, law and order situations. And I would say that women officers indeed have done the uniform and the nation proud because of the trust reposed in them, because they are supposed to be the compassionate, face of the police department, what used to be brutal, what used to be a half butcher and half human, has been transformed into a totally humane face of the police before the public. And that is what independent India requires. Kriti ji.
Integrity, honesty, excellence, professionalism. Those are very inspiring words that you're using, sir. Ma'am, coming to you, what are the challenges ahead? And how do we address those challenges?
The challenges, though I wouldn't like to see it from the point of view of being a woman, if I see it as a professional officer, taking out the gender from me. In fact, I wanted to ask sir what he thinks. Of course, he has been very positive. He's, in fact, more feminist than any other woman. And he's always encouraging to the women folk. But I wanted to understand from male perspective, what makes them think at times that, you know, women are very frail, delicate, they cannot handle tough things. And there is also a thinking that women keep on asking, going on leave. Bacche ko koi bimari ho gaya, then they will ask leave. It will be first the woman who will ask the leave, ask for leave in the department rather than the male, the father. So, there is a perception that women keep on taking childcare leave, maternity leave, and then it gives a break to the, continuity of work, and the work suffers. All these perceptions are there. Of course, these are challenges as an administrator, as a person at the head of any unit, how to handle these issues. In fact, we ourselves, because as a woman, I cannot give up on the household duties, and I see the same for any other woman, because the woman will be called for to attend to her household duties if the child is suffering, if the family is suffering. She has to attend to the in-laws, to the children. And so how do we really strike a chord between the societal expectations, which act as pressure on her, and the expectations at work? It is very difficult, and it's a tight rope walk. And we are doing it, and it's only when men at work understand these compulsions of women, I think they'll be more sympathetic and empathetic to their cause. Yeah.
Dr. Singh, before I ask the next question, Rupa ji wants to elicit a male's perspective on this.
I would be very frank with Rupa ji and you. The fact of the matter is that the women are the stronger sex. They only ask for leave only once in a while. What about the alcoholism, gambling, indiscipline, and the lack of communication with the male counterparts? I can say that there are two stumbling blocks as far as the entry of women officers is concerned. The one, the cult of masculinity that prevails in the police department that has been built in the last 150 years. And the second is the conception that perhaps women may not be equal to the task that is assigned to them. But the ground reality is that women have proven to be better combatants. Look at Madam Kiran Bedi, look at Madam Kanchan Chaudhary, look at any number of women who have been combatants of the best type and who would in fact give the run of the money to any commando in the regular RAFs or the regular rapid action forces. And I would say that yes, women do require, there's a requirement of leave and there is a requirement that have to be addressed. But that is nothing in comparison to the requirement and the time and effort required to address and straighten out the issues pertaining to the male officers. Look at the indiscipline, the gambling, the alcoholism, and the problems that is brought about by their male counterparts. And the women counterparts are an epitome of discipline. You, as you say, in case of particular two-wheeler, fill it and forget it. You tell a woman officer a task to be assigned and forget about it. In case I can tell you, I have to remind my male counterpart at least 10 times before I can even expect a partial compliance of the instructions. In case of ladies, you just ask them and what you expect. Waqt se pehle aur umeed se zyada.
Right, sir. And expanding the scope of this discussion and talking about states, according to the 7th schedule of Constitution, police and public order are state subjects. Now, MHA has repeatedly asked states, given the advisories, to expand or to increase the representation of women to 33%. How are states faring, sir?
The states are faring reasonably well, but I would say that 20 years ago, I prevailed upon and convinced three of my junior colleagues to send their daughters to the police department. The three daughters qualified, but at the last moment, their parents refused to send their daughters to the police department. From that day till date, Bihar has exceeded 23%. Himachal Pradesh has also gone into the double figures. Many other states, but the magical figure of 33% is a far cry. And I think we need to go on a fast forward mode and ensure that this 33%, it is not only for the sake of figures only at the time talking about, it is also putting across the humane face of the police department, giving some credibility to the department, because credibility comes over a period of time. And I would tell you from personal experience, the more the number of women police officer and personnel in a police station, in a police lines or a battalion, the greater is the credibility of that particular unit. And therefore, it is in the interest of the nation and the police department also to have a larger number. At 33%, I would only say, is the basic minimum. You will require more, because in view of the Nirbhaya orders, there are investigations that have to be totally women-specific, where only women police officers, investigators, prosecutors, and those who are interrogating have to be women personnel. Agitations involving students and women are taking place. Therefore, the requirement of women personnel and police officers is going to increase from time to time. Bihar and Himachal may be a success story, but states like UP, Madhya Pradesh, Delhi, and other paramilitary forces had a long way to go before they rest on their oars.
Also, sir, I'm reminded of another proposal or another advisory that was given by MHA to create more posts for women constables or sub-inspectors by converting the vacancies of male constables. What has been the impact, sir?
I don't think there's been much impact in the sense that there was no serious effort. I would say because I'm privy to the fact that there is continues to be a bit of reluctance in getting more number of police women. There is a basic requirement. There is no denying the fact. But still, we have to see, and we, as I said before, I said it mildly, that we have to get on a fast forward mode. Now, I would say we have to go on a war footing to get the requisite numbers. Not only those 33%, but the existing vacancies of male police personnel, if they're not available, we need to transfer them to the women police personnel and get them the requisite number of women personnel and officers in the department, in public interest and in national interest, because the requirement is such. Because you often would see that even when it happened in Hathras, it was the male officers who accompanied the deceased to the hospital and not the women personnel, as is mandated by law. And many other cases where there is tremendous miscarriage of justice. And to ensure that it does not happen anywhere, we need to have more police women all over, especially in police stations, police outposts and police paramilitary battalions.
All right, I'll take this to Rupaji. Rupaji, in case of heinous crimes against women, atrocities, rape, trafficking or even dowry attacks, the presence of women police officers, that instills confidence in the victim to come forward and lodge a complaint. How has been your experience on the ground?
I fully agree with you. Where it is related to women related crimes, a woman will be more forthcoming with a woman inspector to tell the details. She will be very hesitant to tell all the gory details to a male officer. So there comes definitely the role of the importance of a woman being there in the police. Then there are also law and order situations where sometimes women may be the protesters. So to handle them, you know, women police are definitely required. Even in case of POXO, dowry and many other women and child related crimes, women do better in handling the cases. Even as, you know, when somebody comes to the police station, the first experience is what matters. There, many a time, the presence of a male will be actually frightening to whether it is a man or a woman, because the police stations have these stereotypical image of eliciting, you know, some kind of fear in the minds of people. So, if there is a woman at the reception, at the door, you know, who will first ask you, why have you come? What is your complaint? Whatever the complaint the person brings, whether male or female, whether that is a cognizable offense or not cognizable offense. If it is a cognizable offense, okay, register it here. Otherwise, if it is not, then give advice to go to the court or to approach. If it relates to any other department, go there, etc. So to tell all these things, women definitely do better, and that will change the image of the department. But then I have another point. Don't relegate women officers, police officers, only to women related things. Yes. They are quite capable of doing general things also, and as sir was saying, they can do better than men at times. One area where I have seen women police officers are underutilized are, I have seen it in my own experience that when let us say an accused comes, I have been able to elicit more information from that accused person as to what happened, why he did it. I mean, somehow the men have given me more information than as a unit head when I went to a police stations in certain cases, and when I spoke one to one with the accused, I found that they told me much more than what already they had told the sub inspector or the inspector of the station. So I think women can elicit better information from the and correct information from the accused and take the case forward. So that is very underutilized. People at the top don't realize that women can be good interrogators, can get good information. So I think they can get good information, good intelligence too. These are the areas which should be explored, because traditionally these are all with the men, even today in the department. So these are unexplored areas where women should be given, should be pushed into, and you know, they should try women police officers in these untried areas also.
Yeah. Dr. Singh, don't relegate women police officers just to the desk job or to the women issues. Probably that also acts as an impediment to their career advancement. Would you agree?
Absolutely. Women, it would be very unfair and unjust to delegate them only to the desk jobs. They have done so brilliantly well in law and order, crime control, anti-corruption work, interrogation of accused suspects, and also interrogation of hardened terrorists and criminals. My personal knowledge of the fact that the UP, STF and ATS has been that lady have proved to be excellent interrogators, because firstly, the trust deficit wasn't there. Second, that they were accused, were aware of the fact that they'll not be subjected to third degree and police brutality. And the third, the emotional quotient and the spiritual quotient was much, much, much higher, even to the extent there was a time when a hardcore international terrorist, sir, do me a favor, I would rather be interrogated by the lady officer and not by you. If this is not a compliment to the lady officer, then what is? The taste of the pudding lies in its eating. And when the terrorist said, sir, I am very comfortable with the lady officer, please, sir, I would rather be interrogated by her rather than by you. So this is, of course, a fact that I'm stating, male, not because of the fact that I have any impediment, but the fact of the matter is I did not have that credibility in front of that accused, as that accused had perhaps for that lady officer. She was more compassionate or had greater credibility than me, and therefore he gave his preference. And lo and behold, as D. Rupaji said, he spilled the beans totally and the confession, leading to the recovery of AK-47 weapons, grenades and whatnot, and also insidious plans for a future terrorist attack. So this is a success story. Wherever, I said before, and I again reiterate, you trust a lady officer and she'll deliver the dividends much, much beyond the expectations of what the department or a senior officer would even expect, much, much more than that.
So we're talking about delivering the dividends. Rupaji, how do we enhance the field exposure of women officers?
By putting them more in the field rather than relegating them to the background. By exposing them to more and more. Yes, maybe galtiyan hongi, first instance, second instance, but definitely they will improve. So the fact that they cannot handle is not an excuse to just keep them away from field duties. You have to send them, they will learn. And of course, they are better learners. Yeah.
Right. I'll also like to talk about another proposal, Dr. Singh, of MHA. In 2015-16, it said that there should be special investigative crime of crime against women in every state, in at least 20% of the districts in the state, where there are 15 police personnel and 5 of them are women. What has been the impact, sir?
I think the impact has been very, very positive, in the sense that at least in many of the northern states, and I find in many southern states too, there are Mahila police stations in very many important districts. And these Mahila police stations are only responsible for investigating and working on crime against women. And here also you would find the success story. The success story is that wherever the women find it absolutely daunting and absolutely a negative aspect of going to a male-dominated police station, they walk freely into Mahila police stations, and of course they have a shoulder to lean on and trust upon, and they can speak freely about the torment and the crime that has been perpetrated upon them and their families. Here is the success story. But again, it has to be very, very sincerely implemented on the ground. The women officers will have to be trained, will have to be trusted, and will also have to be debriefed as to what is the backdrop. As I remember very well, that initially when the Mahila police stations came up, they began with an element of distrust that they will be dysfunctional. And lo and behold, there were certain officers also who did not trust them and did not give them the basic infrastructure, the basic backup. A Mahila police station is not supposed to be bereft of male staff. The male staff is there for security duties, for arms and ammunition handling, and also for a backup and for the driving and also other tasks that may be required. It is not that only the Mahilas will also look after the barracks and the arms and the ammunition. No, it's not. It doesn't function that way. Once the necessary backup has been given, the Mahila police stations and the lady police stations, as they're called in some states, became a success story to be replicated in Bangladesh and Nepal also. But then the officers and the police leadership will have to run the extra mile to ensure that the necessary backup, the budget and the support is given to them. Then there is no looking back, Kriti ji.
So another cause of concern, of course, is attrition rate among women police officers, especially among constables. Ma'am, what is your take? How do we address this challenge?
No, I don't think there is attrition in government sector much, especially in the police force. Of course, they may be going on leave now and then, maybe some long leave, extraordinary leave, maternity leave of 6 months, and childcare leave for certain ranks. But attrition is not there. I haven't seen too many women leaving the force. So that's a good thing, actually, compared to corporates. There is security of tenure, and there are other perks which are not available for the corporates, and that is why I don't think in a police department, where even among women, there is any attrition.
Dr. Singh, would you agree?
Ms. Rupa has already shed sufficient light on, because there is not much attrition, but if you compare the figures with the male police personnel, it is almost 10 times that of male police personnel. But when the comparison between the police, both the male and the female, the figures are indeed much, much higher. But in comparison to the corporate, it is nothing. It is not even pittance. But why in case of men? Men, in case of police, is a dream job. In case of women, the family responsibilities, the childbirth, the marriage, looking after the family responsibilities, they are solely shouldered by the ladies and not by the men counterpart. And therefore, if there is 2% attrition, I don't blame it on them. But this is the societal requirement, that is only the lady who will have to face all the family responsibilities and not the husband or neither the father. And therefore, even then it should not have happened, because the department and the government have ensured that if there's childbirth, if there is marriage, there is adequate number of leave that are available to any personnel. And therefore, they should take recourse to taking leave rather than quitting the job.
Many a time women join police force, this applies to men also. They are looking for better jobs. If they, for example, especially if a woman gets a police job as a constable, if she would have written some other exams, and if she gets a clerical job as the first division assistant or second division assistant, she would like to shift. And similarly for a sub-inspector, because there are 4 levels of entry. One is constable level, sub-inspector level, and the DYSP level. So if they get better jobs, if a sub-inspector has written some other exam, many of them even qualify in civil service. So that also leads to, the figures will reflect in the attrition rate.
Very true.
And of course, women particularly, because many... in the households, women are discouraged from wearing a male-like police uniform. ये क्या uniform है हमेशा, like मर्द जैसे, मतलब you keep walking, and these things, you know, the women, society still expects women to be feminine, wear jewelry and all these things, and the uniform. Probably sometimes, you know, she'll be told by the in-laws or somebody ki the one is the uniform, which is very much visible. And then second thing is you have to go at the call of the duty at odd hours, sometimes in the night, at any odd hour. So that call of duty, that also makes them, come under pressure that it is not in line with what her family expects. So these are all the reasons why a woman will be sometimes compelled to leave the job.
Nonetheless, society is changing. Women cops are marching ahead, and these figures substantiate our assertion. On that note, thank you so much for joining us. So that's all we have for you in this edition of Discussion today. Thanks for watching and stay tuned to Rajya Sabha TV.